As we begin this program, we'll start with an invocation, Kurayondrum Illai. The video that will play out for this invocation was rendered by Bharat Ratna Srimati M.S. Subbalakshmi. This was during a visit to the foundation when this building was first inaugurated. It has a very special connection for us. The words are also special, written by Shri Rajaji. The words also mean that you have nothing to ask for. We have achieved everything, or we have everything that we could need. So we will be playing out the song. We can remain seated for this song then. As we come together in this mission for a zero hunger world, there are many important pieces of work that are happening across the region and the country. To formally welcome the distinguished delegates and all invitees who have made time to be here today, for which we are very grateful, I'd like to invite Dr. Madhura Swaminathan, Chairperson MSSRF, to deliver the welcome address.
So
so happy to see so many old faces here that I think some of you have been here and associated with the foundation longer than me. So you should be welcoming me, but hearty welcome to all of you in particular. We are very happy today, honored today to have Honorable Minister Krishna Byregowda, who is Minister from Karnataka, Minister of Agriculture. Thank you, sir, for coming. We have Secretary and Director General of ICAR, who all of you know, Dr. Mohapatra. We think of you as part of our family, not as a special guest. And also very delighted that we have Dr. Maria Andrade, who has made the longest journey possibly amongst some of us today, coming from Maputo, who is last year's World Food Prize winner, for having worked on the team which developed the orange flesh sweet potato. And I think not just developing it, but taking it to the last mile. Now, so converting it into the impact and the nutritional impact, I think that's what is most energizing about that. I'm not going to name everybody here. We have so many national and international institutions represented, partners, donors of MSSRF, and I think somewhere at the back also young students, because I think what is very important is that we shouldn't be an organization which is all above the age of 50. We need the younger people to take the message forward in the coming years. I'm not going to say much more. We have a three-day consultation on farming systems for nutrition. But I just want to say one thing, since I have the space here right now. People talk about the nutrition enigma or the nutrition paradox. Frankly, I don't see what is an enigma or paradox about it. So I'm going to put my foot in my mouth here. See, if the public or the government invests in something and then you don't see returns, then it's an enigma. I think in India, we have not invested in nutrition as we should. So what is the paradox? If you don't invest in something, you don't see the returns. So I think that we have people who are in very powerful positions here who are investing in research on agriculture and nutrition. So I think the plea here is that we have to do more. And we have not, you know, met our commitments on expenditure on health, on expenditure on education. There's no commitment even for nutrition, on expenditure on nutrition. So what is the enigma? I think the first task and challenge here is to demand, and we come from many countries over here, demand that we invest more in nutrition. So I think that's the message which is unambiguous. And but having said that, then come the questions: how, why, you know, for whom, how to go about it. And I think those are some of the issues that on which we need to, I would say, question every assumption in the book. And starting from, you know, the farm or the agricultural system till the child, the individual, the mother, every, you know, boys as well as girls, I think we have to question and examine every assumption on how, what are all the things that affect nutrition, because it's one of those things which is the ultimate outcome is an individual person. And there's such a combination of factors that actually affect nutrition. So I hope over the next few days, we're actually going to examine very closely the research and policy agenda. But I think, I hope we also get a commitment from everybody in this room that we're going to actually do more and spend more for nutrition. Thank you very much.
Ma'am, I'd like you to formally welcome the minister with a shawl as a small token of our appreciation for his being here. And invite our executive director to welcome Dr. Mohapatra, please. And our Director of Food Security, Dr. Rukmini, to to welcome Dr. Maria Andrade and Dr. Bhavani, Program Manager Lansa, to welcome Dr. Purvi Bhatt. It's also just to tell you that we are having a live uplink of the proceedings of the three-day program on our website, www.mssrf.org. And you can also use, if you are active on social media, hashtag MSSRF NutriFarm, which is what we're using for our social media updates. So as we have already started with a recommendation right at the start to invest more, I would also say invest more time in talking about nutrition to everybody. I'd now like to request Dr. Selvam, our Executive Director, to capture the work done by MSSRF over the past year. There's over 30 years of work nearly that we have been doing, and he has, as Executive Director, he will present in a nutshell what we have done during the past 1 year.
Respected Professor. Chairperson Dr. Mina Swaminathan, Honorable Minister for Agriculture, Government of Karnataka, Mr. Byregowda, and dignitaries on the dais and off the dais, delegates, colleagues, and friends. I am very happy to present the highlights of the work done in the MSRF during 2016-17. Before that, I would like to briefly introduce the foundation. MSSRF was established in 1988 with the proceeds received by Professor with the World Food Prize. And it's a non-profit organization recognized by the Government of India, Department of Scientific and Industrial Research, as a research and development organization. And the Ministry of Finance, Government of India also has accorded the status of scientific institution. The vision of MS Swaminathan Foundation is to link science and society for equitable and sustainable development. And to achieve this mission, our mission is to develop and demonstrate models of sustainable development for large scale replication, as well as to influence the policy with pro poor, pro nature, and pro human perspectives. To achieve this, we undertake participate in research and developmental activities in the area of agriculture, rural development, and natural resource management. And also, we focus on anticipated research, particularly with reference to agricultural adaptation to climate change and adaptation to sea level rise. We work in six themes, that is coastal system research, biotechnology, biodiversity, ecotechnology, food security, information, education, communication. Climate change, gender, and grassroots institutions are the cross-cutting themes. Our program, now currently we are working in eight states, from Bihar to Orissa, Andhra Pradesh, Kerala, Karnataka, as well as Maharashtra, and also in Pondicherry. And we work in the biodiversity hotspots of particularly in the tribal dominated belts of Orissa, Tamil Nadu, as well as in Kerala. And we have three regional centers apart from the head office. We have a community agrobiodiversity center in Wayanad in Kerala, as well as fish for all center in Pumbavar in Tamil Nadu, and Biju Pattanaik medicinal plant garden and research center is in Orissa, in Jaipur, in Koraput districts. Our total staff strength is about 295. Now coming back to the highlights of the work done, that I have grouped our activities into three themes. One is on adaptation to sea level rise. Second is the farming system for nutrition, and ICT for development. The goal of the first theme is to enhance adaptive capacity of local community and other stakeholders to rising sea level. And the first intervention is related to this is mangrove related interventions. Because the mangroves, both Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change as well as United Nations Convention Framework on Climate Change considers mangroves as the first line defense against the sea level rise. Because the mangrove forest floor is a kind of a living floor, it means that it grows every year annually. Every year it grows by the accumulation of sediment as well as by litter. And the increase in the height of this mangrove forest floor is almost equal to the predicted increase in sea level rise. That's why it's advocated by the IPCC as a soft solution to the sea level rise. And with keeping this in mind, that we have been working on mangrove restoration for a very long period of time, and we have developed actually the model for large-scale replication. As a result, Indian mangrove forest cover has increased by about 70,000 hectares over a period of 15 to 20 years. But now we also started restoration work in about 250 hectares in Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh and Maharashtra. The major difference is that this time that a majority of this restoration is taking place in the land owned by the revenue department. Mostly the mangrove restoration used to happen only in the lands owned by the forest department. For the first time, particularly in Andhra Pradesh, that the government has given about 200 hectares of revenue land for mangrove restoration. The second intervention is related to integrated mangrove fish farming system. It's a kind of innovative model which integrates aquaculture and mangroves. And it's a kind of extensive tidal flood system, which is eco-friendly because no chemicals is used to maintain water quality, or no artificial feed is used for the culture of fish. And it is recognized by and promoted by the German Technical Cooperation as Blue Solution. And this large-scale replication is going on both in Vietnam as well as in Philippines. And during this year, we have started converting 50 hectares of abundant stream farms in Machilipatnam into an integrated mangrove fishery farming system with the support of Adaptation Fund. In the future, that we would like to demonstrate aquaculture techniques with the support of National Center for Sustainable Aquaculture for the livelihood security of the dependent community. And the third intervention related to adaptation to sea level rise is biosaline agriculture. And here the main idea is to develop and demonstrate and packages of cultivation practices for halophytes. Halophytes is a group of saline tolerant plants that grows in hypersaline mudflats. And it is, many of them are considered as a future crops, and they have commercial potential. During this year, we have selected six species, three succulent halophytes with different kinds of commercial values, and also three halophytic fodder grasses, and conducted field experiments. And the main thing that I would like to say is that the optimum salinity for the maximum biomass production is about 8 to 20 grams per liter. Previously, we thought that we can grow these halophytes in very hypersaline conditions. But what we found out that, beyond 20 grams per liter of salinity, the biomass is, it's gradually reduced with increase in salinity. And the future focus is that we would like to identify allied germplasm of these halophytes. And also, we work some more on these agronomic practices, and also the molecular characterization of some of the selected species will be done. So, both for research and education purpose, we also established a genetic garden of halophytes in Vedanium. It has collection of halophyte species collected from both Tamil Nadu and Andhra Pradesh, and we are also conducting survey in other states, and those collections will be kept in this genetic garden, and it was recently inaugurated by the president of Mauritius. And the fourth intervention related to the adaptation to sea level rise is the promotion of cultivation of saline tolerant crops. We have two different approaches. One is developing transgenics for example, already we have developed a saline tolerant rice varieties with the genes isolated from a mangrove tree called Avicennia marina, which is which can tolerate very high salinity. And these varieties can tolerate salinity up to 8 to 10 grams per liter. And already single location field trials were conducted with the approval of the Government of India. And we are waiting for the lift on the ban of these kinds of GMs for multi-location trials. And during this year, we have initiated work to isolate and introduce saline tolerant genes from wild relative of rice called the Portoricea purpurata, which go profusely in the mangrove environment. And apart from this, we are also promoting cultivation of saline tolerant traditional varieties, and also we develop varieties through conventional breeding. And so far, we have collected about 31 saline tolerant rice germplasm from the coastal states, including the very interesting variety called the Gaga variety from the coastal Karnataka. It's almost equal to the Pukali variety, another very famous saline tolerant variety is grown in the Kerala, which is widely used for in the conventional breeding. So these saline tolerant varieties are being evaluated, and the multi-location trial is going on in Kalpakkam as well as in Machilipatnam and Kumta in Karnataka. So the identified germplasm will be promoted for cultivation in saline soil. And I would like to mention that we are really thankful to the Department of Agriculture, Government of Karnataka, for extending support to demonstrate the reclamation of coastal saline soil particularly in the districts of Uttarakhand, using these using halophytes as well as the saline tolerant and traditional kaga varieties. I'm just showing some photographs related to that, and we are conducting participatory on-farm trials with the different varieties of different cultivation practices. And we have also established two seed banks, kaga seed banks, in Kumta villages, and it was recently inaugurated by one of our trustees, Dr. Hegde. So this what I would like to conclude in this theme is that we have a package of practices as well as products that are available to enhance the adaptive capacity of both farming and the fishing community in the coastal areas. Normally, if you see the literature, it is, the adaptation to sea level rise is discussed mostly in theoretical form, that we have now practical solutions for this, and it's my earnest request that we will associate with ICR for upscaling. the second theme is the farming system for nutrition, that the major goal is to provide agriculture remedies to nutritional maladies. And we have five different kinds of interventions. First is the demonstrating the location-specific model farming system for nutrition. Second is the establishing a grid of genetic garden for biofortified plants that provide materials for the farmers to cultivate nutrient-dense plants. And then third is the creating a cadre of community hunger fighters. And the another important aspect is the communicating to the stakeholders through various media, both for awareness and most importantly for behavioral changes. And then the fifth activity is related to policy advocacy. And currently we are demonstrating the farming system for nutrition in seven villages in Koraput in Orissa, as well as in five villages in Wardha. Apart from that, the lessons learned from these experiences is now being used for policy advocacy in Orissa, Maharashtra, as well as in Andhra Pradesh and Bihar. The main aim is to make the agriculture policies of these governments more nutrition sensitive. apart from this, with UNICEF as well as with the Tamil Nadu Planning Commission, that we have started another project mainly to communicate communication related to the nutrition, and we have also developed a knowledge management portal which will be launched shortly. So the main idea is that during we have a lot of experiences to share, and those my colleagues will share these experiences then the next during the consultation. And the future focus is that we would like to demonstrate operational model of integrating agriculture and nutrition for freedom from hunger as well as malnutrition in the three districts of the Koraput in Uttar Pradesh, Koraput in Jaipur, as well as in Thane in Maharashtra, and the Indian Council of Medical Research, ICR, as well as the state government and MSRF will be the lead partners. And the third theme is to ICT for development, and the main goal is to integrate various ICTs in building resilient rural community. And we have the popular Fisher Friend mobile application, which provide ocean conditions as well as potential fishing zones to fishing population. The most important thing is that the INCA is the Indian National Center for Ocean Information System. They installed a number of sensors in the ocean, as well as even the fish potential zone is captured by the satellite. All those data comes to the INCA and it is transmitted to MSRF apart from all other partners, and in MSRF it is converted into advisories and then it's sent to the fishers through mobile. And we are now working in Orissa, Andhra Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, as well as in Pondicherry and Kerala. And the most important thing is that we closely associated with INCAISM, and we conduct systematic feedback studies how these really the advisories works, or what are the problems related to applying these advisories, or whether the information is given is equal to real time observation. All those kinds of feedback studies are done by us, and it is provided to the INCAIS, and that helps them a lot to refine their data dissemination, even in designing their sensors. And apart from this, we also conduct case studies mainly to understand how these advisories really benefiting the fishing community. The future focus is that we would like to develop pan-India application, particularly that we would like to work with the already we have partnered with CMFRA in Karnataka to expand this model, and also we are going to work in Maharashtra, Gujarat and West Bengal. Mostly this, in these states, the mobile application will be implemented through our partners. Apart from this, there are some concerns that whether these applications real may affect the fisheries resources, because it may lead to over-exploitation. And we would like to conduct scientific studies to see whether it's really happening, or if it is, then what kind of solutions, what kind of changes we can make in the in the data collection as well as in the advisory will be studied, and this will be provided to the INCAs to refine their methods. And we also work with the farmers, and we have a farmer friend program, and through which that we are providing location season specific need based real time information agro advisory. And apart from this, we have another interesting program called the Plant Clinic Program, and which actually addresses the pest and disease in the among the farming communities. Then we also have the farm schools in three states, through which more than 1,000 farmers actually benefited in learning various crop cultivation techniques. Apart from this, these farm schools also act as farmers-to-farmer learning platform. Then we also have the rice biopark project in Myanmar. This is one of the international projects that we are implementing now. And MSSRF and the Department of Agriculture Research Myanmar, and they participate, and they are the partners in this. And we have almost, the work is completed. And this resource center will act as a training and demonstration center for various techniques and processes related to value addition to straw, bran, husk, roots, as well as the grain of the rice. Recently, we have organized a training to 9 senior level officials of the Department of Agriculture Research of Myanmar, and particularly on value addition. And this park will be inaugurated in the first week of September 2017. So these are all some of the glimpses of the work we have done in the last year. And we are very much thankful to the Board of Trustees for their guidance and support, as well as to the Council of Directors and staff of the MSRF. And we are also thankful to all our partners, particularly the community, Panchayat Raj institutions, state and central government, as well as national and international agency for their continuous support. Thank you very much.
It's difficult enough comprising 1 year's work in a presentation. What about a lifetime of work? And that's what we are now going to launch. We have the launch of the e-archives of Mrs. Mina Swaminathan, who's done incredible work in gender, in early childhood development, and has also done a lot of work on theater. So all of this is going to be showcased on a portal and left there for sharing and for people to learn from. To do this, I'd like to invite Mrs. A.S. Padmavati, who's a long-time associate and who's known her for over 25 years, and who herself is a very accomplished communications person.
Thank you so much for the opportunity. I have my association with auntie. We all call her only auntie for the past 25 years. Somebody who linked culture with agriculture. In fact, the entire foundation project access department used to be having lot of singing, dancing and whatnot, theater, because Mina is a person who was interested in everything. She's a theater person. She had even written a song for early childhood education. So, and she's a person who's very passionate about her. In fact, great taskmaster. Every day morning she will bring a long sheet paper to everybody and paste it in our desk. So this is your day's work. So to give this, she must have worked there the previous night. So real taskmaster, but really, we really enjoyed. We could learn so much. And in fact, I learned to link women's concerns with children's concerns and children's rights. When we talked about breastfeeding, she said we must talk also about maternity benefit for women. So she was a person who taught us how to be a feminist at the same time being very compassionate about the entire human being, not in the traditional sense of being a feminist, you'll have to be anti-male. She was a person who taught us to be a very passionate feminist. And That's all. I can keep on saying, but this I'll stop this. I have a family association also with her. The entire family has worked with us. I have done films for foundation. Nyani has done. And my son, when at the age of 13 years, when he did a video documentation for the foundation, he spoke very professionally. Mina said, this is the first person from your host who's talking about professionally. Both of you, when she used to ask me and Nyani about what is the fund related to this, I'll say, whatever is possible, give auntie. But my son is a person who's professionally, he said, you must behave like your son. So thank you, auntie. Thank you so much for this opportunity, for the foundation, and for auntie. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. From one source of knowledge to another, our executive director mentioned very briefly about a partnership with UNICEF, where we are looking at knowledge management as a very important component of actually taking forward the work we've done. This conference itself is a step in that direction, where we are bringing together work from across different regions to see if we can have some sort of an outcome and push for policy. Knowledge management for nutrition is going to be facilitated by MSSRF through a portal that we are currently developing for Tamil Nadu. And to do this, I would like to request our beloved professor to launch this portal. And I'd like to request Mr. Job Zakaria, Chief of Office UNICEF Tamil Nadu and Kerala, to please join us on the dais. Thank you, sir. More on that maybe a little later. To proceed with our program, I'd like to invite Dr. Manju Sharma, trustee of MSSRF. Sorry, I think she had to leave a little early. So I'd like to call on Dr. Purvi Mehta Bhatt, deputy director and Asia lead for agriculture, Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, who leads the foundation's agriculture strategy for Asia, including links between farming systems and food systems. So she's on board of several international alliances, and nutrition and agriculture is her particular area of expertise.
Thank you very much. First of all, a very warm happy birthday to you, sir. I am here to represent, of course, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, but for me personally, being here today, as you know very well, means a lot. This has a very, very special meaning to me. I have written about this, so some of you know about this, but about 29, 30 years ago, as a graduate student studying plant genetics in the US, same department as Maria, but she's much younger to me, so I'm saying 30 years ago before her. I used to, as a graduate student, used to have a small picture of Prof. Swaminathan cut from a magazine. And we used to have a small desk and a glass on the desk, and I used to have a picture below that glass. And when my peers would ask who this person was, I would say, I've never seen this person. He is M.S. Swaminathan. I've never met him, never seen him, but he's a geneticist who brought green revolution to my country back home. And to be able to stand here and celebrate his birthday today, it's a huge, huge personal honor for me. And later on, as I got the privilege of working with him and traveled with him and so forth, and as my own understanding of Prof. Swaminathan's philosophy sort of started evolving, I sit down now and wonder if I would still call him a geneticist who brought green revolution to India. I think I'd call him much beyond that. I would call him a geneticist whose knowledge of sociology, economics, and ecology is far more more thoughtful and in depth than most sociologists, economists, and ecologists I've met. I would not call him the father of green revolution because this is a father of green revolution who brought the revolution and frankly didn't stay in that revolution. He kind of evolved himself into becoming the father, truly a father of farming systems. I have worked with Professor Swaminathan on issues like livestock, for example. Dr. Hegde is here. And he's understanding to be able to bring the entire farming system, livestock, aquaculture, sericulture, and all that together in true sense. And therefore, I'm really very glad, Madhura, that the conference this time is focusing on the farming system view. Because this is something that we as people who were trained in those genetic silos learned from Professor Swaminathan, and that is to look beyond that one gene and look beyond that gene's function into the plant, but that gene's function ultimately in affecting people's livelihoods and people's nutrition and so forth. So I would now, looking back, I would not call him a geneticist. I would not call him the father of green revolution. I would call him the father of farming system and the father of food system because of his contributions to nutrition as well. The Gates Foundation, as many of you know, works in India since 2007 with our stress-tolerant rice varieties and so forth. 2 years ago, we decided to completely revamp our agriculture investment strategy in India. And nutrition became 25% of our agriculture strategy for India. And agriculture became about 20% of our nutrition strategy for India. So those kind of looking at the system view, I must say, in designing those strategy also, we have been very, very greatly influenced by Professor Swaminathan. And so I'm really glad to be here, sir, and to pay that tribute and to show that in-depthness for a lot of people like me personally, but a lot of the strategies for agriculture in this region who has been affected by and influenced and motivated by your way of holistic thinking. Thank you very much.
We will now have our release of the 27th annual report. The first copy of the report will be released, and may I request the Honorable Minister to release the MSSRF's annual report and Dr. Mohapatra to receive the first copy. We have the release of the booklet on farming system for nutrition, about which this conference is based, and compiling the work that we have been doing on this and the thematic explanation of various strategies that have been adopted by MSSRF are compiled in this book on farming system for nutrition. And I'd like to request Dr. Mohapatra to release this book and Dr. Maria to receive the first copy, please. I'd like to invite Dr. Maria Andrade. We are very honored and privileged to have her in our midst, the 2016 World Food Prize laureate, who has extensive experience in working on root crops and
knowledge that their benefits would be substantial if diets are supplemented. Her deep interest in biofortified crops have meant over 30 years of work experience in Africa, and she serves as CIP's country liaison scientist with the government of Mozambique and has worked closely with other CJR institutions in the region. She will be spearheading the sweet potato support platform for Southern Africa under the SASHA project. And we are very glad that you could join us and talk to us at this inaugural session. Thank you, ma'am.
Good afternoon, panel. Good afternoon, audience. I am so happy to be here. It is amazing to be around so many important people. Special Prof, because I have admired you for a long time, because I always thought you care. Food has been always an issue very big for me, because I'm coming from Sahel, sub-Saharan Africa, where there is drought, there is flood, food is never enough. When I was 5 years old, I told my mother I was going to study agriculture and feed people in the world, especially in Africa. What is quite interesting is because I chose humble sweet potato. Why humble sweet potato? Because I always associate them with women farmers, with children. And this happened to be when I arrived in Mozambique in 1995, when I was reading a report for the first time. I had an assignment as a regional agronomist, and I read a report in Mozambique which says 46% of children are stunted, under 5. 72% of children are vitamin A deficiency. I happened coming from finishing my PhD right there, and I study a lot the beta carotene in sweet potato. And very soon I understood that all the female farmers knew how to grow sweet potato, but there was no orange flesh sweet potato. UNICEF by then was supporting all the supplementation in Mozambique, but the country is so big, and about 25-30% of children were rich. So I said, why not start introducing orange flesh sweet potato and evaluating and working with those women in the village, and let it be as a sustainable way, using a food approach to address vitamin A deficiency in the country. But we were very happy because there was also a group of Jan Low. We happened to be in Mozambique by then. So we wrote a strategy how we're going to do. Of course, we understand from the very beginning that like this is not only sweet potato, the food itself will do, but also we have to link it with nutrition and also make it into the market. So this took about 23 years of my life in Mozambique. And what is interesting, going on the same step, coming down, but very believing that we're going to really make a difference. And today, for example, 33% of all sweet potato grown in Mozambique is orange flesh sweet potato. And in Africa, we already brought 14 countries together with us. And we have reached close to 3 million households with our orange flesh sweet potato. But it's not only that. What is quite important is the community nutrition, the partnership we create, and for a cause, vitamin A deficiency for Africa country. So I'm very happy I'm associated with you, addressing hunger, addressing malnutrition, but in a very small way. Because I believe no crop, nothing is small. If you really do, nothing is small. Because a big success is a combination of small, small, small things. And I believe if you are there, you have to make a contribution. Every each one of us can contribute. If it's in agriculture, you contribute. If it's in nutrition, you contribute. Because we are not here for accident. We are here to really do something. That's our legacy. So thank you very much. And I'm taking this opportunity to wish you happy birthday. It is really a pleasure. I cannot believe this. Because I don't believe nothing is for granted. If I'm here, it's for a reason. And I don't waste opportunity. I will take this opportunity to do something good for my own continent and for the world. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. A former director of the Indian Agricultural Research Institute and director of National Rice Institute, Dr. Mohapatra, who I'm now introducing, has been a researcher and teacher for several decades with specialization in molecular genetics and genomics, with several distinctions and awards to his credit. An esteemed fellow of INSA New Delhi and National Academy of Sciences and Academy of Agricultural Sciences New Delhi, his position is of particular importance in adopting nutrition approaches to agriculture. So inviting the Secretary to the Government of India, Department of Agriculture Education Research, and the Director General of ICAR to speak.
Good afternoon, everybody. Respected Professor Swaminathan, Honorable Shri Krishna Byregowda, Dr. Madhura Swaminathan, Chairperson MSSRF, Dr. Maria Andrade, other dignitaries on the dais, and also many dignitaries of the dais, all the delegates. In fact, I have no words to express express my gratitude, because I am here today getting sentimental about it. Because past 20 years almost, barring few exceptions, I have been coming over to this place, and very specifically on this date, to meet Professor Swaminathan and greet him on this date of 7th August. So today I take this opportunity to wish you many happy returns of the day and pray before the Almighty to give you strength and good health in years to come. Sir, you are the person who led from the front in 1960s to give this country food security. 55 years later, a remarkable one, you are guiding this country to be self-sufficient in nutrition front. There will not be any parallel in history, any example that the same leader providing the dynamic leadership and dynamic guidance to a country and to the globe as a whole in the direction of attaining self-sufficiency with regard to food and nutrition, and more so today for nutritional security. Sir, we are all indebted to you that your vision, your visionary statements, your leadership that has given so much of strength to this country, and particularly the department which I represent now, that so eminently you represented and led and you established. The country is indebted to you, sir, for your visionary steps that you took and still continue taking despite your age. Today, under your, again, the same dynamism, we have all gathered here to discuss farming system for nutrition. In fact, the other day, at the residence of the Honorable Prime Minister, you eloquently spoke about doubling farmers' income, the wage and means, and your points that you so clearly mentioned and emphasized often have been circulated to all of us, all the departments, and they are the guiding forces for all of us to work on and to deliver. And today, with this particular discussion on farming system for nutrition, we would again be guided by your vision. And in fact, a few years ago, there was a similar discussion here, and I was speaking about some of the work that we were doing at the Central Rice Research Institute. At the council level, we have many programs already on with regard to technology. If we talk of farming system for nutrition, first and foremost is technology. The country emphasizes on fortification of food, but certainly, as you keep talking about, we have to have biofortified food. Maria's work is a beautiful example in this direction. The sweet potatoes fortified with beta-carotene. My colleague, the director of Central Tuber Crop Research Institute and the ex-director, they're all here working in this direction. We have beta-carotene enriched sweet potato in this country that needs to be taken forward. Past 1 year, sir, we have developed 12 different varieties in different crops, biofortified with protein, vitamins, micronutrients in different crops. And these varieties could be the starting point to biofortify our food for nutrition. Sir, you talk about culinary diversity in this country. We are also indebted to you for giving new slogans, new phrases, coining many, many words, including several things, in fact. Don't want to count one by one. And we keep working on those. But technology is one. But taking them to the farmers is yet another issue. ICAR is developing models for farming system, almost 45 different models, tested at different locations. They have been defined and designed to meet the requirement of nutrition, also addressing the income issue of the farmers. And these 45 integrated farming system models, which encompass often fishery, animal component, as well as horticulture component, in addition to crops and millets, which addresses nutrition adequately. But at the same time, we are, in fact, establishing these models in all the Krishi Vigyan Kendra. Because that would be the first step to take to the farmers. We have now 680 farm science centers in this country, at least one in every district. And these integrated farming system models with nutrition focus and income focus and sustainability focus are going to be established so that they will be demonstrated amply to the farmers for the purpose of familiarizing farmers with the technology and demonstrating the strength of the technology. And recently, sir, with under your leadership, We met with ICMR. Dr. Somya is not today here. But we are committed to take this farming system for nutrition models to three of the districts which are actually indicated in the past presentation. And we are going to work together to demonstrate in these districts. And as you rightly say, sir, green revolution came in this country primarily because the strength of seed and other technologies put together were demonstrated in different villages of the country under your dynamic leadership. And today, again, you are leading from the front. And these technologies, once they are demonstrated in different villages, I'm sure the benefits of farming system would be harvested by the local people in their homestead gardens and also otherwise, so that the kind of problems that we face with regard to nutrition insecurity, large-scale children, the expecting mothers, and so on and so forth, hopefully you'll be able to meet that. So time is running, and instead of taking more time, I once again express my sincere gratitude to you and also others for inviting me to be here. Before I leave, I can assure you, sir, the Indian Council of Agriculture Research and Department of Agriculture Research and Education would be all time interested to partner and to work together with MSSRF and also the state governments to take these technologies to the farmers and also help governments design and define policies so that the biofortified crops not only are grown but also are supplied through midday meal to the public distribution system after proper tagging in the markets, segregation in the markets, so that the consumers benefit, so that we address this issue of nutrition in this country. Sir, we are always looking forward to your advice and always will be there with you and seeking your blessings. With this, once again, I pray before the Almighty for your good health and a long life, full of life, and also, as it has been, full of ample satisfaction. With these words, thank you very much, and wishing all the very best on this birthday of yours, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. Very heartening to hear all the various initiatives and your tone of optimism, which really keeps us charged up at the start of this conference. To deliver the keynote address, I'd like to invite the Honorable Minister for Agriculture, Government of Karnataka, who's been holding this portfolio since 2013 and has made many visible changes to the approaches to agriculture and nutrition in the state. Most notable is the active procurement, promotion and distribution of millets. MSSRF has been privileged to be a small part of some of these discussions. In a way, with your able vision, Karnataka is a model in showing how effective implementation of right to food can happen, especially in promoting nutri-rich millets. Welcome, sir.
Good afternoon. I'm in the midst of doyens of agriculture science community, and I'm not an agriculture scientist. I'm a social sciences student and who happens to be in politics as well. So for me, it is not a common sight to be in the midst of such distinguished people, people of science and agriculture science. That being one side, to be in the presence, and not just in the presence, but to be on the stage, sharing the stage and at the invitation of Mr. Swaminathan is altogether a different lifetime experience for me. So I'm honored today to be here in the presence of a legend, a true legend of India. We hear of many legends, but to be in the presence of one who is still amongst us is a very rare privilege. So I'm honored by the invitation of the foundation to be here, particularly on his birthday. And from my side also, sir, the best wishes and happy returns of the day. And we are privileged to be here sharing this day with you today. We are here to talk about farming systems for nutrition. Somewhere it is implied that we need to move the discussion beyond food security towards nutrition security. So it is also an implied critique of the approach of food security. If not everybody agrees with that, some of us may think so. But everything is a journey. Life is a journey, development is a journey, social evolution is a journey. At one point, food security occupied our priorities. And thanks to the guidance of people like Dr. Swaminathan, we have achieved it. So every day, we must pause for a moment and celebrate the achievement in our country of food security, which many people didn't credit us as being capable of achieving. So yes, some harms may have been done in our pursuit of food security, but nevertheless, to have food security itself is an enormous national achievement that has given us unquantifiable, not just self-respect, self-reliance, but a certain standing which we could not have achieved without. Yes, now we do recognize that there were our singular pursuit of food security has brought with it certain other effects which we didn't anticipate as well. Like I was saying earlier, everything is a journey. We don't have access to perfect knowledge. We discover something, we pursue it, we achieve it, then we realize that there is something else also. So once that knowledge is rectified, a new discovery is made, we try ourselves in that direction. So agriculture science development is also sort of a journey. Development is also a journey. So now we must strive towards nutrition, nutrition security, and farming systems for nutrition security. One of the outcomes of this national drive for food security was that whatever we had prior to it, the food systems we had, the nutritional systems we had, the dietary practices we had, they partially went out of fashion. So rice and wheat somehow also became aspirational. So as affordability improved in our society, the signs of affordability affluence became rice, wheat, flour, sugar, oil. So now we are facing the consequences of not only the food security, but the aspirations that came with social affluence as well. So somehow the both happened at the same time. And on one side, now we have dietary imbalance. As a result, India is emerging from the second position, I'm sure we'll move to the first position in terms of incidence of diabetes. We are taking very firm steps in that direction of achieving the distinction. So the alarming thing about diabetes incidence in India is that I think it occurs 10 years earlier at an earlier stage compared to some of the other countries. So we have high chances of hitting diabetes in our middle age, and we have managed to contain communicable diseases in our country. There is a great amount of control we have come to establish on communicable diseases, but today what is uncontrollable are the non-communicable diseases, starting with diabetes, leading to all kinds of other lifestyle-related illnesses, and the whole gamut. I will not get into that now, but that is the big health challenge our country is facing, and that challenge is snowballing, the non-communicable disease challenge. So on one side, we have an imbalanced diet, which is causing all these issues. And on the other side, we're still dealing with calorie deficiency and, of course, nutritional deficiency of micronutrition, major nutrition. So there are deficiencies across all boards. One of the interesting things also that some scientists have observed in India is that even in cases of low caloric intake, diabetes incidence has been found. I believe that is not normal. It's so something that shows about even where there's below daily minimum caloric intake, people have diabetes, which shows somehow we are prone to diabetes in our country. Maybe historically we were used to a certain diet. That diet has changed today, for which our body systems are not tuned, and hence that shows greater vulnerability for non-communicable diseases. So nutrition deficiency on one side, and perhaps high caloric intake of particular types leading to all kinds of health challenges. So these are what we have to deal with today. And one way to address all these challenges is to work towards nutrition and balanced nutrition and nutrition security. If you have to work towards nutrition security, it has to be backed up by farming systems for that objective. Now, what I just spoke are about science. Now, I'll speak a minute or two about the social issues that are affecting this. I briefly mentioned it earlier. So, nutritionist foods somehow went out of fashion. In my state, the nutritious foods somehow came to be over a period branded as poor man's foods. And the moment you had affordability, you switched to these, as I mentioned earlier, rice, wheat, flour, these types of foods. So whatever was nutritious came to be branded poor man's foods, so it is not fashionable to eat them. So when you talk about nutrition, this is a social challenge you face. How do you overcome these biases that are built in to our ways of thinking today? So you have to overcome social biases against nutritious foods. Not only that, may offend a few people now, in the policy making and the agriculture science community also, there are biases built up. And Dr. Swaminathan himself pointed out that the nutritious cereals in agriculture science are called coarse cereals. So there is a, of course, a scientist would defend there is nothing wrong with the word coarse cereals, it is just a description, but for me who is not a scientist, it somehow sounds contemptuous, a dismissive. The name may not be intended, but conveys a sense of dismissive attitude towards a group of cereals which are very nutritious. And with the guidance of Dr. Swaminathan, in our state, we don't call them coarse cereals anymore, though the textbooks do continue. We, in habit, we call them nutri-cereals, that is the millets. So we are following the advice. So, and of course, pulses also fit in into the discussion. So there are social biases built at every stage in the minds of policymakers, scientists who are driven towards high-yielding, high-productive systems, and we have to overcome those. And in the minds of the consumer, a certain contemptuous attitude towards nutritious foods of being poor man's food, so we need to see how to overcome those as well. So it's important. Of course, this is a gathering of scientists, but nevertheless, we can't ignore the social mores, habits, mindsets also that guide our behavior. So unless we overcome those, we won't be taking effective steps towards nutrition security. So I briefly talked about the imbalanced diets, the social challenges, and I'll quickly talk about another challenge which we are facing in Karnataka and to a larger extent in Southern Peninsula. So when we talk about farming systems for nutrition, it ties in very well with climate change, because the kinds of agriculture systems that we have promoted are at a greater risk in the era of climate change. And for the last years in the state of Karnataka, we have experienced continuous droughts, and the rainfall deficit is ranging in 30, 40, 50%, and in some seasons going up to 60, 70%. So 3 years consecutive drought, everybody is alarmed, we are all shaken, but somehow we policymakers, scientists, public, we don't see the link between climate change and these consecutive droughts. But that's a separate issue, I won't get into it. But in the midst of scientists, let's just say that there is a climate change that is impacting us, and it is impacting us in real terms. And when we talk about climate resilient agriculture, again, the crops that have produced this imbalanced nutritional situation are not conducive for climate change scenario. So they are not climate resilient crops. So which are the climate resilient crops again? So it are the nutri-cereals, the family of millets, pulses, and other legumes. So these are again fit from the climate change point of view also. So nutrition, climate change, both meet in the form of nutritious crops that are being talked about here in this conference. So it is, I think, very relevant from the national point of view. And with strong encouragement from Dr. Swaminathan, we in Karnataka have, in the last 3 years, have taken up several initiatives to further this objective. First has been our campaign. So one is, of course, we focus on government initiatives, but we have taken this campaign to the public domain to popularize millets. So there has been a certain revival of millets, awareness about millets, and increasing consumption of millets in Karnataka we, government and many agencies, have come together to promote. And that is leading to definite changes in consumption patterns. There is a greater uptake of millets that we notice in the last one and a half years due to the 3-year campaign that we have been running. So this is an awareness campaign. This is not a, it is a government-backed awareness campaign, but it is not a government scheme as such. So, but it has been effective. So I think when we, earlier I mentioned about social habits, so if the objective has to be achieved, there has to be a larger awareness campaign towards nutritious foods. Secondly, as based on Dr. Swaminathan's recommendations, we have already started distributing ragi and jowar through our public distribution system, though in a limited way, but we have started that. We also offer the MSP fixed by government for ragi, jowar are not adequate in our view. So we have a standing policy that every year there will be MSP plus 400 rupees per quintal. So it's a standard guarantee from the government, right? We will top the MSP with a 400 rupees state bonus so that farmers get a higher price for these millets. And we procure unlimited quantities of ragi and jowar. We procure unlimited quantities. How much our farmers grow, we buy back. And we put the whole thing back into our PDS system, whatever is procured. And we, our PDS is free, so we substitute it for rice and wheat. So the entire procurement goes back into PDS. So in one sense, you could say we buy it from the farmer, in one hand, sort of give it back to them free, in another hand, because it comes and goes back, because PDS is there with 80-85% of the households, and in the villages, 97% of the people have, the farmers have PDS. So that is one program. And also we have started pulses also. So pulses are part of our PDS as well. We don't give them free, but we give them at approximately 50% the market value. So the rest 50% subsidized by the government. So we are trying to gradually incorporate into, because when we talk about nutrition, many of the activists turn back and say governments are responsible for the imbalanced diets because of the way our PDS is designed. So we encourage, by giving free rice, we encourage rice consumption. So we are trying to partially correct that. The other thing we are doing is, when we talk about farming systems, why are farmers addicted to growing paddy and wheat and sugarcane? Because they offer a certain income security to a great extent. So unless we address that issue of income, I don't think whatever we talk about would be received well by the farmers. So what they are, their triggers are about incomes. So millets, pulses, or other crops, they are not the natural choice for farmers unless their conditions require them to grow them. So we need to really work on improving the yields of these crops so that they become remunerative for farmers, and only then widespread cultivation will be taken up. I think Dr. maybe last one of the conferences in Bangalore, Dr. Mohapatra was there. So we need to accelerate our investments into research of these nutritious crops so that, you know, they can fetch better returns to the farmers. One thing we are doing in Karnataka is we have tied up with our universities and ICRISAT and NCBS for a consortium-led project where we are basically fast-tracking new varietal improvement by DNA sequencing, and DNA-based molecular selected breeding of ragi, jowar, tur, groundnut, and Bengal gram. So we have now done the sequencing of majority of these, and based on the DNA mapping, the breeding process is now accelerated. So in next year, we will start getting results of better yielding crops. And once we can give to farmers these high yielding varieties, then our advocacy will gain strength and farmers would start responding as well. So I think this 3-day conference of people who have been working on nutrition, policymakers, scientists coming together of minds would set the record or the direction towards this objective, and it is a rare distinction that this reorientation is also being led by Dr. Swaminathan, who also led the drive towards food security. Now he is also leading the drive towards nutrition and nutrition security. I'm sure out of this conference we will find solutions to many of the challenges in this direction. And I, from our side, from the state government side, we are committed to this objective of reorienting our priorities, our messaging, our systems towards nutrition security, and we would be very happy to take away and try to implement some of the solutions and try to demonstrate some of the possible solutions in this direction. Once again, thank you for inviting me here and giving me this rare honor. And also thank you all for a very patient hearing.
Thank you, sir. It's very inspiring to hear about the work and the commitment and way you're pushing forward a lot of new innovation. I don't think I need to introduce our next speaker because that's our dear professor who's going to speak, but to say how much we look forward to his vision and his guidance at every meeting and at every time he speaks, there's always a huge message in there for us. So look forward to hearing you speak.
Honorable Minister, my colleagues on the dais and friends who are participating in this very important discussion on farm reorienting farming system or mainstreaming the nutritional dimension in ongoing farming system. How do we mainstream? That is the idea of the conference. But before I talk a little bit about the conference, I wish to thank all the speakers for their kind words about me. Very kind of you to made such kind remarks. How do we, farming system is what is common ever since agriculture started. It can be, as the minister said, in fact the minister has covered all the important points. crop animal fish, crop agroforestry. You can have different kinds of farming systems. Cropping system is just rice, wheat, jowar, and so on. But what our farmers usually adopt is farming system for two reasons. Essentially, agriculture, even today, is designed to meet the farmer's own home needs. Secondly, the market needs, of course, but the home needs give priority. And there they would like to have a mixed diet. This particular, from concept to action, farming system for nutrition is now FSN, as abbreviated. Who is operating? Jayshree? Well, Madhura referred to the Indian enigma, or paradox as you call it. When you go abroad these days, about 10 years ago, 15 years ago, people used to talk about India, the home of green revolution. Now they talk about grain mountains and hungry millions. because we have 40 to 50 million tons, 60 million tons, sometimes in government godowns. Many of them are poorly stored. I've seen them in the Punjab, Haryana region. Storage is not, it's improving, but not so good. The loss, and I will come to it later. Agricultural progress, India has been cited as one of those countries where there has been good agricultural progress, but we have persistence of malnutrition. The International Food Policy Research Institute's own hunger index shows us in a very bad light. Mm. Of course, their criteria are somewhat questionable, but nevertheless, it shows in a bad light. Green Revolution is a country. This is the worst part of it. Wherever you go now, they ask about farmer suicides. Why are the farmers of India committing suicide? A country known for Green Revolution, a country known for the public distribution system, a country known for the public procurement and minimum support price and so on. So these are kinds of issues which are normally being raised, and they all need to be considered very carefully. The unfinished challenge, as the Honorable Minister has already said, when you want to shift from food security to nutrition security, according to the International Food Policy Research Institute, India ranks 97 out of 118 countries in the 2060 Global Hunger Index. 97th rank in 118 countries. 39% of children under 5 are stunted. These are well known to you. These data have been repeated, so I won't go into it. But those who... Now, one response to this situation, sad situation, is how to bring agriculture, nutrition, and health through farming system for nutrition. Can we bring all these three elements together? Now, one of the proud moments of India was when I was a member of parliament at the time, Rajya Sabha, when we passed the food security bill, spearheaded by Professor Thomas. And one of the things which we were very, very, very proud was a country which was known as the country which was born, independence was born with the Bengal famine, now says right to food from homegrown food. Legal right to food from homegrown food is the kind of progress which have made for the famine. And the bill itself has certain interesting features which are important for the farming system design. That's why I'm highlighting. One is a life cycle approach with emphasis on the first 1,000 days of a child's life. The first 1,000 days when the brain development and the cognitive abilities of the child are very much influenced, the nutrition, the first 1,000 days. So that if you are designing a farming system, can we design in such a way that we can take care of the needs of both the young and the old? The senior-most woman, the other thing which the Act does is to give acknowledgement to the rightful place of women in the food security system. They are in charge of food security, so the entitlements card or whatever it is given to them. The third very important, which the minister already has done it in Karnataka, is to enlarge the food basket from wheat and rice to a whole series of other grains, what we call nutri-millets. We also call it climate-smart nutri-millets.
Yes.
You put in the word climate-smart. Yeah. In fact, I remember after World War II, when there was a shortage of wheat and rice, wheat was also still coming from abroad. Mr. K. M. Munshi, who was then the minister, and his wife started Annapurna, new kinds of restaurants, not like McDonald's, but restaurants in which the dosa or idli or any other dishes were all made from millets, ragi and millets, both for the substitute to wheat and rice, but Mr. Munshi also said they are good for your health. The entitlements will vary from time to time, but nevertheless, at the moment, 5 kilograms of food grains at 1 rupee for millets, 2 rupees for wheat, and 3 rupees for rice. We now want to eradicate hunger completely from our country. What are the 5 pillars? You can put more pillars to eradicating hunger. 100% access to adequate food all year round. That's important, food all year round. Zero stunted children less than 2 years of age. All food systems are sustainable. This is goal two of the sustainable development goals of the present. You know, the UN Millennium Development Goals were replaced by sustainable development goals. There the goal two is food systems should be sustainable and 100% increase in smallholder productivity and income and zero loss or waste of food. That's important. The last one, the zero loss or waste of food. There are three dimensions of hunger which we discussed in the whole farming system. Number one is calorie deprivation. That can be overcome in our country today. But protein deficiency, mainly pulses. Chhattisgarh has introduced in its own Food Security Act, because states can their own Food Security Act, the introduction of pulses in the public distribution system, in the PDS, and also they have put iodized salt and PD in the PDS, public distribution. Micronutrient deficiency is now the most important problem we are facing. The ministers and the speakers have highlighted what the problems of the micronutrient iron, iodine, zinc, vitamin A, vitamin B12, vitamin B4, all of them are important. And however much you may eat calories, how much consume calories, you still have a problem if the micronutrient deficiency is. So one of the approaches to overcoming the problem of micronutrient deficiencies is also called the hidden hunger, because not so very transparent, is three kinds of approaches. One is there are naturally occurring biofortified foods like moringa, sweet potato, nutri millets, and so on, and fruits and vegetables, as well as milk, eggs, and other forms. There are a large number of biofortified plants and animals in the natural state. We can also do breeding of biofortified foods. In this foundation, for example, there are iron-rich rice, which was by breeding. Similarly, some of our companies have introduced iron-rich bajra, Nirmal seeds, for example, which is breed by normal Mendelian breeding, not by. The third approach is genetic modification. A classic example of genetic modification was the work done by Ingo Potricus on genetically biofortified golden rice. It has not been approved for release in most countries. And also there are a lot of controversies about but there are certain kinds of golden rice which are now available including IARI, which have taken into consideration some of the criticism. But our regulatory system, I may say, sir, in our country, unfortunately, so far, we do not have a regulatory system for genetic modified food which can help to assess risks and benefits in a very transparent way, in a scientifically sound way. We should have some kind of. We have in other areas like nuclear power, for example, Nuclear Power Regulatory Authority. But in the case of genetically modified food, there is no. You already mentioned about the need for culinary diversity. The more you have introduced millets, I think today's food also can hear the dosa was thing is from millets. You can now make a wide variety from our Koli Hills experiment and so on. Shamai, Tenai, Panivarga, Kurvarga, all of them. You have make a very wide range of dishes. And that is one sure method of overcoming malnutrition. If you have got a diversity, just as genetic diversity is an insurance against genetic vulnerability against pests and diseases, culinary diversity. Sunita Narayan and her group have been publishing now a number of recipes for breakfast and lunch, which are based on culinary diversity. Well, Dr. Shalom already mentioned about coastal area farming, because farming system could be ecologically also should be defined. Coastal areas, hill areas, dry farming areas, arid zone, semi-arid zone. We have got here in outside in this building, and outside this hall, the five major agro ecosystems of Tamil Nadu, described 2000 years ago in Shangam literature, Kurunji, Mullai, Nedal, Palai, Maradam. Now, when we talk about farming system, it has to be in relation to the particular ecosystem. It will vary. The hill ecosystem has certain opportunities. Silvi aquaculture, and also in Kerala for a long time, the old Travancore area, the next one, has always had practice fish, coconut on the border, fish and rice during the monsoon season when there is some fresh water, because salinity control is the most important. The water salinity control is the most important. One fish. This 1 minute before we go. This particular system has been recognized by FAO as a globally important agricultural heritage system. Developed by farmers, and unfortunately, they are farmer scientists, of course. We call in this foundation every farmer a scientist, every child a scientist. So, scientific temper, as Nehru said, it is not science. You will not be a scientist to have a scientific temper. Scientific temper must be there in everybody. Questioning mind, really, it's a questioning mind and understanding the facts. So, Kerala farmers, in one of the most beautiful days, call it God's own country, that area. And you find long ago they developed method by which they can grow rice below sea level. They have now established, the Kerala government has established an international center for below sea level farming. In the case of Orissa, Koraput is another problem area. For a long time, malnutrition was very highly prevalent. In fact, Orissa was formerly known, not now. It has leapfrogged. One of the very bad areas from the point of view of nutrition. Here, when we started the work 20 years ago there, we introduced the habit of developing four banks in each of the villages. The gene bank, that is the local varieties, the seed bank, the grain bank, and the water bank. This particular system of food and water security received the Equator Initiative Award at Johannesburg in 1992. The UNDP established the Equator Initiative Award, and one of the first awards went to the tribal families of Koraput. In fact, one Komala Pujari, tribal lady, went to Johannesburg to receive the award. Already a mention has been made of genetic gardens of biofortified crops. The genetic garden for biofortified crops, mainly for the purpose of both conservation and education, and the ability for the farmers to have access to biofortified crops. It serves the Center for Conservation and Nutrition Education. What you do, I think Dr. Shalvam and his colleagues are trying to use some land in this campus for laying out a demonstration on genetic garden of biofortified crop. The genetic garden consists of plants which are rich. If you want to know what are the iron-rich plants, then you can see in the garden. If you want to see what are the vitamin A, your own varieties are all in the genetic garden, your new variety, for which you got the World Food Prize, rightly so. Most common micronutrient deficiencies for humans are iron, vitamin A, folate, zinc, selenium, and so on. We would like to see these gardens be put up in every village, mainly as a source of information, which plants contain what. Secondly, as a source of material for the farmers. If I go on saying you mainstream nutrition in the farming system, farmer will ask, all right, I will mainstream nutrition. Where is the material? I think somebody mentioned about seeds not being available and so on. Here is our World Food Prize awardee sitting next to us, Dr. Maria. She and her colleagues developed orange flesh sweet potato. Sweet potato is not developed by them, but the new variety of sweet potato. And as was mentioned by Madhura, they also demonstrated the impact of that variety on human well-being. It is not enough to say you have got more vitamin A and so on, but the bioabsorbable units of nutrition, bioabsorption is very important. Finally, you might be conclude by saying, if you want to have a malnutrition free India, then the first thing is eliminating undernutrition. Dr. Gopalan always says undernutrition is the cause of malnutrition. A food-based approach than a drug-based approach is important. So eliminating undernutrition or calorie deprivation through the effective implementation of the provisions of the National Food Security Act. Because this act not only wheat and rice, but also nutri-millets like ragi can be provided at a very low cost. Secondly, including pulses, as Chhattisgarh has done in the public distribution system, in order to ensure that protein hunger is eliminated. We had a pulse year in this hall itself, 3 years ago, International Year of Pulses. Production of pulses has gone up today in our country, but the minimum support price announced is not adequate in my view, although it is better than before, but the procurement is very bad. Procurement is bad, and also there are imports at the wrong time, imports at a cheaper price. So that the monsoon and the market are the two major determinants of a farmer's well-being or farmer's fate. The monsoon has been, as you rightly said, has not been very kind. The market is also, if it's not kind, then the farmer is in great difficulty. And therefore, it is important that we have our own policy. Sometimes the World Trade Agreement and so on are quoted. But I think it's a country where 50% of people depend on the livelihood on agriculture. We have to have different rules in the World Food Trade Agreement. Not the same rule cannot apply. Overcoming hidden hunger, I already mentioned it, the biofortified plants, and we have to have a large education program here, a nutrition literacy program, and one, the Krishi Vigyan Kendras, and so on will have to become. We also have here, I think Dr. Raman Narayan is here, who was running a course for community hunger fighters. We have not only these biodiversity gardens, but also community hunger fighters, men and women selected from the community and trained in the science of nutrition, and also not merely science of nutrition, but also in the method of overcoming malnutrition. Both are important, and they in turn educate. In other words, you have a multiplier effect. If you take 15 or 20 persons in the village, if you educate them, each one of them will educate more people. In that way, for example, the Green Revolution, in 1964, there were 4 hectares under new varieties of wheat. In 1968, when Indira Gandhi released a stamp called the Wheat Revolution, it became 4 million hectares, 4 hectares to 4 million hectares. 4,000 years of history was condensed in 4 years. So that our farmers can do, because it becomes a mass movement run by the farmers. So long as we do it, we can't do it. But if it's taken over by the farmers, they will run with it. A small government program can become a mass movement. Finally, effective steps should be taken for other things like drinking water, sanitation. Normally, we are not including them as food security, but drinking water is so important. Sanitation, primary health care are important. All of them, how are you going to do it? It is essential, as you said, I think, also Mohapatra said, the social engineering aspects of program design. The community involvement is important. Farmer-centric methods of implementing, both designing and implementing the program is important. Lastly, we should have more collaboration among organizations in the country, scientific organization. ICMR has a lot of expertise. The National Institute of Nutrition is part of ICMR. Then there is ICR, as the whole farming system. They have a volunteer coordinated research project on farming system. MSSRF has its own specialty. So we recently, ICMR had convened a meeting in which both Dr. Mohapatra and I were there, and it was decided that we should take up 3 districts straight away, the organizations, the 4 organizations, ICMR, ICR, MSRF, and the local district collector or district administration. Thane has been chosen in Maharashtra, Gorakhpur in Uttar Pradesh, Koraput in Odisha, and Pudukkote is ongoing of MSRF, both water shortage and water conservation. So just as I said, we could achieve much in the 60s. In 4 years, you could condense 4,000 years of history. In the same way, we can leapfrog in terms of overcoming malnutrition in the country, provided we look at the problem in an integrated way, in its totality, not one segment alone, not my vitamin A tablets alone or vitamin A oral dose alone, but look at the whole system of nutrition of the individual and train a large number of people at the local level, what I call the community hunger fighters. They can do a lot in terms of education. So, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for coming for this important meeting. I hope, as the Honorable Minister already said, at the end of next 2 days, there will be an actionable program. Because theoretically saying this is, we are short, if free publishes, if free is there intended for that purpose, publications on nutrition status and so on. But we have to ensure, knowing what status we have, how do we go to the next step from food security to nutrition security? How do we move from food security to nutrition security? Thank you very much for your patient listening. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. The two key take homes, looking at an integrated solution and to come out with a very concrete action plan. We hope that will happen during this conference and beyond. To deliver a formal vote of thanks, I'd like to invite Dr. Anil Kumar, Senior Director, MSSRF.
Respected Professor, distinguished Chief Guest of the Day, Mr. Krishna Byregowda, the Agriculture Minister of Karnataka, our overseas guest, Dr. Maria Isabel, the ICR Director General, Dr. Mohapatra Ji, the Bill Gates Foundation's Asia Agricultural Chief, Dr. Purvi, my chairperson, Dr. Mudra Swaminathan, our Executive Director, Dr. Selvam, the Board of Trustees, distinguished dignitaries here, my colleagues, I can see some of my earlier colleagues as well. So the Foundation's Day, this August 7th, is always a special day for MSSRF. Because not only because we are celebrating Professor Swaminathan's birthday on this particular day, he is being with us to celebrate this day, but he is also making a point that, you know, he brings the best brains available in the area of sustainable agriculture to come over here and discuss with us and find solutions for the burning issues of India. So the farming system for nutrition, the next 2 days meeting. In fact, this particular subject area, which we have been, MSSRF is into this project and into this program for quite a long period of time. Sir, let me start with a formal thanking to Professor Swaminathan. See, he is a great inspiration for all of us here. Today he had completed 92 years of his life in this planet. And by when he completes his centenary year, the next 8 years, today he has presented a very beautiful action plan, how to make India a malnutrition-free India. I would feel the best tribute to Professor Swaminathan, if we can take a pledge here, see all of us here. So by when he celebrates his 100 years, that next 80 years, if we can make this country malnutrition free, the hunger free India, because that will be 5 years before the 2030 the designated year for attaining the sustainable development goals. So with the help of, I'm sure, the ICR system, with the help of other institutions, we should be able to reach that particular goal. Sir, with all humility and humbleness, I propose a great vote of thanks to you, sir. And we wish many, many happy returns of this day. And we see that 2025, also you will be with us to celebrate this particular vision. And you have listened to our chief guest today, the minister, how eloquently he spoke. Sir, you have touched all the important points. When I have listened, you touched both the supply and issues and the demand and issues. Particularly when you, quite often, you know, we forget about the demand side issues, particularly the consumer behavior and the consumer preference, consumer choices. Largely, I feel that if we work upon that particular dimension, if we can change the behavior of the consumer, we can really achieve many, many important goals. And he has touched the climate change aspect. If you look at the India as a whole, we know we are experiencing the climate change in a very, very severe form. And the point which you made, most of the nutri crops are climate resilient as well. Not only with the cereals and millets. I see, basically, I'm a trained botanist. I know many of the plant genetic resources which are nutritionally important are equally climate resilient as well. So we thank you very much for having you with us, and we look forward to work with the state government and also people like you to work to move forward. Sir, Mohapatra ji, he is in fact the leader of one of the biggest agricultural institution systems in the world. The ICR, if you look at the number of institutions he handles, and his guru, Professor Swaminathan, he is one of the, I think he is the second youngest DG for heading the ICR. And we have been listening to you, sir, your resource capability, your managerial capacity. See, to run this kind of a biggest institution, that is a great challenge. And we thank you so much for being with us today. And you have spoken very well about how ICR has planned to move forward with the farming system for nutrition, you know, how best we can achieve this goal. Madam Isabel, Maria Isabel, when I had studied your CV, which you narrated today, how you started your life, she has in fact bred more than 30 different sweet potato varieties. And amazing factor, out of these 30 varieties, 20 are now in large spread cultivation in different parts of Africa. Millions of hectares of area has been covered by, say, one scientist making this kind of an impact. Then imagine one institution, how best an institution can make. So we thank you so much for being with us today. And we are looking forward to have your association in future as well. And Madam Purvi, so the Bill Gates Foundation, as she said, had come to India with the biggest agenda. 20% of their money they are going to invest on nutrition, 25% of their money on nutrition, and out of it, 20% will be from the agriculture, which means the agriculture for nutrition or leveraging nutrition in agriculture. We understand your larger agenda, and we will be having association. We hope to have association with the Gates Foundation and you, madam. Thank you so much for being with us today. And our executive, the chairperson. So the chairperson, she is our driving force, I would say, with a very smiling face always, but with very kind of, you know, she sees how best the program has been is getting finalized here, especially next 3 days program. With her help, you know, we should able to shape it up very well. Madam, we are very, very thankful to you for your guidance and support. And the executive director, Dr. Selvam, he is in this position for the past 2 years, and he is leading us with a very, in a very, treading very cautious steps. I would say not getting into problems, and you know, but very cautiously he is leading us. And we thank you very much, Dr. Selvam, for holding this particular meeting in a very, very cautious way. And let me thank all our board of trustees first and other dignitaries here for coming over here and attending this, going to attend this particular meeting. And I must mention two names here, Dr. Bhavani and Dr. Rukmini, two women colleagues of me. They are actually spearheading our food security program here. In the sense, you know, they run the actual on the ground actions. So I take this opportunity to thank both of them, and we will have a strong association with their team to take this today's, you know, the learning from today's meeting. Finally, I would like to thank the media here, both the print media and the visual media, and also various committees. See, to hold this kind of a meeting, that there is so much of effort going in, and we have various committees. I take this opportunity to thank all those committee members. Finally, ladies and gentlemen, I thank all of you to attend this particular meeting, and I look forward to have all of you for the next 3 days as well. So thank you so much. Thank you.